Moim rozmówcą jest Robert Scovill. Hi, Robert.
Hi, Bartek.
Could you tell us, please, about the adaptive technology by the EAW and the system ANA, and how do you compare it to the other line sources on the market?
Right. Well, you know, adaptive's hallmark is really that it is not a mechanically articulated PA system, meaning we don't do any mechanical aiming with it. We have a driver density in each one of the cabinets that's very high. Like in ANA cabinets, we have 14 high frequency drivers, 6 mid-range drivers, and 2 woofers. So it's a very dense package. And what that allows us to do is, through DSP, do any kind of aiming with it. Even with a stack this short, we could do plus or minus 90 degrees of vertical coverage with it without having to change any angling in the cabinet, right? Mm-hmm. So we have these very nimble coverage patterns that we can do. We can make it perfectly match a geometry. So that's the calling card of adaptive, is to be able to do
that. Yeah, that sounds outstanding. But how about the horn? Because we don't have a physical horn, but you said that this shape creates one horn.
I get asked this question a lot. You know, people talk about, you know, is adaptive as efficient as horn-loaded systems? And it just doesn't seem obvious when you're looking at it, but this is actually the horn, right?
Yeah.
So in the case of ANA, this is a 70 degree horn with the drivers down the center. With ANA, I believe it's a 100 degree horn. And as you add more cabinets in a horizontal fashion, it decreases it by about 10 degrees. So the main difference between this and mechanically articulated is that when you are stacking mechanically articulated, right, you are stacking horns. Mm-hmm. Here you are just creating one horn, essentially, right? So mathematically, acoustically, this is operating as a single acoustic source. It is operating as one speaker, even though we have multiple enclosures.
Yeah, that sounds amazing. How about the connectivity on the back of the speaker?
Yeah, this is all Dante driven. We have Dante primary and secondary systems. I believe this was probably the first big PA system on the market that offered Dante with Dante redundancy for both audio and control. So yeah, it's all Dante delivery, analog failover, so yeah.
Teraz patrzymy na wnętrze systemu wysokotonowego, systemu ANA. Robert, could you tell us, please, about the high frequency?
Yeah, of course. So this is the high frequency element from an ANA. So we've basically taken this module out, put it up here, and turned it around. So you can see this is the 8 high frequency drivers all on 1-inch spacing. This is the mid-range drivers here, all on our asymmetry exit horn. And all of this, each component of this offers its own DSP channel and its own amplifier. So that allows us to do a lot of work with it in terms of being able to aim it and get it going where we want. But this is also some insight into, you know, people get concerned sometimes about the weight of adaptive boxes. But, you know, when you're comparing box to box, there's a lot more componentry in a box like
ANA. It's not a fair comparison.
Yeah, it's not really a fair comparison box to box. And that's how many times with adaptive, we can actually do a better job of covering and have the same output capability as much, you know, in fewer cabinets than you would have with mechanically articulated, right? So it just comes down to density and the density of the componentry, right?
Mamy tutaj zestaw złożony z 4 elementów, a co gdybyśmy chcieli sobie zwiększyć zakres horyzontalny takiego grona? Możemy dorzucić drugie. Robert opowie nam teraz o zależnościach, jakie zachodzą między tymi zestawami.
Yeah, it all works off of one flying beam. So if you want to expand horizontal coverage in 100 degree increments, you would literally come in with a second array and attach it to this array and expand it. You're basically creating a barrel-shaped array, and the most important part of that is that mathematically and acoustically now it is one acoustic source for the bottom end, for the low frequency, right? So it becomes very powerful, very efficient. The computer system knows where all the cabinets are. We have little IR sensors up here in the top, so it can sense where any cabinet is in the array and adjust the output accordingly so that you don't get big buildups, so low end, etc. like that.
It's so the computer managed system will just compensate the low end, yeah?
That's correct, yeah. So once you start to add low end together, obviously, mm-hmm. you're going to get some gain, and it will manage it back into place so that you get really good, even horizontal coverage.
Okay, Robert, the adaptive is like for 10 years now on the market. How do you find about the future?
I think the future is very, very good for adaptive products. I'm on record as saying this, and I believe this, that we're going to find out here over the next few years how far ahead of its time adaptive was. It was way ahead of its time, maybe decades ahead of its time. You are just now seeing other competitors start to try to match this kind of density in the mid-range because they understand what it takes to be able to do some of the things that we've been doing with adaptive for a long time. So the future for it is really, really good. It's still a very popular product at EAW. We the last 2 years have broken sales records for adaptive, even as long as it's been in play, and I think it will continue to do that going forward. So it's a platform. We're heavily invested in it. We'll have next generation products coming.
Yeah, no, I know some people who bought AC6 and they're really impressed by that.
Yeah, it's going to be around for a long time. Yeah. I really believe that.
So. Thank you, Robert.
Thank you.
Stoisko, Soundtrade, Soundedit, Łódź. Dzięki.